Okay, so hello everyone, I am Krishna, and today we'll have a look at barycentric coordinates. So mostly the goal will be to understand why it works and why it's useful. And there'll be a few problems as well. I mean, a few just applications to like well-known results. But I believe that after this class, you'll have enough theory to start getting the results yourself. So that's the goal of this class, to just get you to that. Okay, so let me start. So let's say we have three-dimensional space. I'm going to represent it this way in general. And let's say you have the plane x plus y plus z equals 1. So does everybody know that a plane is of this form? For reals A, B, C, D. Someone can say yes if the general question is. Okay. So basically, if I consider the plane x plus y plus z equal to 1, it's going to intersect the axes. On an axis, the other two are 0. So like x plus y plus z is 1. If you look at its intersection with the x-axis, that means y and z both are 0. So x is just 1. So basically, it's going to intersect in these points, and the plane is going to look like this. I'm not drawing the whole plane. I'm just drawing a triangle. So like the whole plane is going to look something like this. So this triangle is equilateral, and that's just because of the symmetry of the system, and like these three lengths are equal, right? So each of them is one unit. So now, let's say, So let's say I pull C now along this axis. So you should get something like this after pulling to some extent. This is your C. You should get something like this, and this is just the same. So this triangle looks something like this. It's isosceles, but it's not equilateral, right? And now suppose here I were to also pull A. You can just imagine holding it and pulling it. So you get this. So now you might get a scalene triangle as well. If you don't pull too much, that again it becomes symmetric or stuff. You'll get a scalene triangle in general. So what we did is that we just pulled these intersections of that plane and we got these. Now let's say that instead of pulling them ourselves, the axes kind of scaled themselves. The axis inherently got longer. The unit 1 got longer. So this was called 1. Now I will call this as 1 unit. I'll call it 1 C unit, let's say. Okay. We're still 1 unit on, let's say, the x-axis. Right? So maybe the 1s of each axis after scaling looks something like that. Now the plane x plus y, so this is 1, 0, 0. The 1 just is different on each axis. It's not the same as it would be in normal standard coordinates. So now this plane still intersects it in like when the other two are 0, so like in these three points. But the triangle that these three points form, and like the whole plane is like this, I'll usually just draw the triangle and you can see where the plane is. This is the plane of the triangle. That's not equilateral anymore. These lengths are not equal. Okay. So now this begs the question that can you get any triangle by varying these? So when I say these are not equal, these refers to what these refer to what I call the units along each direction. Okay, so let's see if we can get all triangles this way by some suitable units. So what we have here is a triangle ABC. Let's take an arbitrary triangle and see if we can find some, those units. Conversely, we'll just take those units and then they'll form this triangle as required. So this is O. So this length is A. This length is B. This length is C. Okay. And let's say this length is X, this is okay, or this is P, this is Q, and this is R. Right? So it's very easy to solve for this. These are all right triangles, so. Would be nice if you guys had like pens in hand so you could do the computation before I did. So now you just get p squared plus q squared plus r squared equals this. ABC are lengths of sides here. In a moment they'll mean something else, but for now they're lengths of sides. So if this is c squared, then r squared is just this minus c squared, so a squared plus b squared minus c squared by 2 is r squared. And by symmetry, p squared will just be b squared plus c squared minus a squared over 2, and q squared will be c squared plus a squared minus b squared over 2. So these things happen to come up a lot. So these kind of terms, they come in the cosine rule, they come in a lot of other places we'll see. So we just give them some names. I'll just call this SA, this SC, and this SB. Okay. So we can see that this P equals root SA, Q equals root SB, and R equals root SC when you put them here. They actually give the triangle with side lengths ABC. And since the side lengths determine the triangle, you can get all triangles. So basically what you can do is just say there exists some scaling of these axes, some notion of the units on each of these axes, such that x plus y plus z equal to 1, the plane x plus y plus z equal to 1 intersects the axes at these points ABC, such that ABC form any arbitrary triangle. There is a slight okay, that I'll come to later. Okay, so is everybody following me till here?
Yeah.
Okay, good. So now let's look at what else we can do. So now we have a triangle where a triangle always has like points around it. So now the next thing is how do we represent points? So like usual problems are two-dimensional and they involve a triangle in general. So you like it's convenient to use the plane of the triangle, that is like x plus y plus z equal to 1. I'll just call it pi. The plane is just called that to avoid writing the whole thing. So this is like our plane of what we are going to work in. So like suppose you have like some diagram, it's actually that diagram just printed on x plus y plus z equal to 1, and you can imagine yourself looking at it from the origin, right? So now how will you locate a point? So let me just show you. So now like thought experiment, you are at the origin and you are looking at this figure, okay, ABC. From now on, the triangle is just arbitrary. The units are all defined well. We know what they are also. And we don't care after that. They're just, this is still 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1. Okay, I might have rotated the system, but that's okay. Still right-handed. So, it's this where the 1 is not necessarily like one actual unit for all these three. They are some three different things. Okay. So now let's say there's a point P. P is in the plane of this, of the whole plane here, in our diagram. Let's say P is a point. So you're looking at O. And imagine, let's say that like this whole plane you're looking is like you're looking at the stars. Okay. So what will you do if you find this star called P? I mean, how will you say that you found it? You will probably like point your hand in the direction of P, right? So you will point your hand in this direction such that sometime later this line parallel to this direction is going to hit P, right? That's how you represent points. So basically, only the direction matters. This is here. The point is fixed because it's on the plane. I mean, that you can imagine that your hand, what do you say? A silly example, but your hand like you flick something and it goes and hits the plane at this point P. So basically that's how the intuition builds for why you represent a point with just the direction. You already know it's constrained in this plane. You just have to just point at it like where exactly it is from the origin. So now this whole line, let's say this vector is P bar, okay? Some vector. This whole line has the equation lambda P bar for lambda being real. So basically R bar is this, right? For lambda equals 1, it's just this point. For lambda equals 1.5, it's this point. For 2, it's this. And somewhere for some lambda, it's this. And then so on. And lambda can be negative as well. So that's one thing you have to remember is that like backward also counts the same. So minus P is also the same as P. Okay. So lambda can be anything. Like the whole line you're taking and not just one ray from O upwards. So now we can say that this line L given by this represents the point P. We already know P is in the plane. You only need L and L will fix where that point is. It's just the intersection of L and pi, the actual point. Okay. So basically this is what this is how you represent a point. So let's say P bar was X, Y, Z, right? This point is X, Y, Z. So you know that P is going to be lambda X, lambda Y, lambda Z for some lambda. And you also know this. Basically, you're doing the intersection. You're saying P is on that line, lambda P bar, and it's also on this plane. So you get lambda X plus lambda Y plus lambda Z is 1. And for now, assume X plus Y plus Z is non-zero. We'll come to that in a bit. So you get lambda is 1 over that. So P is just X by X plus Y plus Z, Y by that. That's the exact point, right? Okay, so basically, whatever P, if you chose 2, I mean, it's just some scaling of that, right? So sometimes this is like just cumbersome to calculate. You know it's on the plane. You don't care what exactly is the length of this OP. You know it's on that plane and you know its direction. That's enough in general. So what you can do is you can just say P is the same as X, Y, Z for some lambda. Basically, just that little bigger or smaller. So you write this denotion or like notation as this. You're saying that the ratios X is to Y, Y is to Z, X is to Z are going to be constant because that lambda doesn't affect. They're just going, all three are going to be scaled by something. You're saying that P is this, where these ratios are constant, but these numbers may not be the exact coordinates of P. For some lambda such that this holds, such that these three sum to one, P is going to be that like with commas, like the actual 3D point, like A, X, Y, Z kind of thing. So P is this. I don't care what those things are, but the direction is this, X, Y, Z. That's where you'll find P. Okay. So is everybody following me till here? So representing a point is basically just by the direction. And you don't care what that constant is, it's just some point.
Yeah.
Okay. Now let's say so you keep you continue your thought experiment and you keep varying like this P bar, keep looking in different directions and like keep like take note of where this point that you are representing is actually going. So like you first choose a direction and then like extend that direction till it hits the plane, and then you get that point that you're representing. So keep doing that. And you'll notice that there is some direction in which you can point such that it's not going to hit that plane at all. Right? So can somebody tell me what that direction is?
Parallel to the plane.
Yeah, so parallel to x plus y plus z equal to 1, meaning this. So it looks like this from a side view, from the view of the b axis coming towards us. This is how it looks. You point in this direction, right? So this is how it looks. It's not going to intersect it at all, ever. It's like train tracks. It's not going to intersect it at all. And these directions, you can also point it. There's basically infinite amount of di infinite directions in which you can point so that it's still parallel to the plane. You just go in a circle and all of those directions will count. Again, notice that this and this are same. You'll get like a bunch of directions, all of which don't intersect that. So basically what you can do is that here all your points correspond to some direction, but all directions don't correspond to some point. So you just assume that there is some point here. It's not in the plane actually. But you just say that I define a point called P infinity P bar, just some notation for the point, such that when I point my hand in this direction along P bar, where P bar is parallel to that plane, then this point is what I'm representing. Okay, so again, that I'll define this point which is not on the plane, which I represent when I point my hand along this P bar, which is parallel to x plus y plus z equal to 1. Okay, so there'll be a bunch of P infinities for different P bars, all like in a circle, all parallel to that, and they'll all form like. There'll be many. There'll be one here. It seems to be like on a circle. So like you'll normally see representation. It's called like extending the plane. So like this is the normal plane. And then you'll just see these P infinities. They seem to be at the border of the infinite plane. Just hand wavy. But yeah, so it seems to be. This is how you'll see. So this is called like the completed plane. And this thing also is just a bunch of P infinities, like all those P infinities. We call this L infinity, just a set of all those P infinities. We call it line for. That's a story for another day, why it's a line, why we call it a line. But, anyways, I'll come to that later in the lecture. So, okay, so, anyways, so all of these P bars, which like represent the P infinities and not like usual points of the plane. These satisfy, like let's say this P bar was x, y, z. Then these satisfy the equation of the plane parallel to this one and passing through the origin, right? And this plane is just, it's parallel to this, so these like the ones in front of the x, y, z will be constant. And just this term will change because it's just a translation. And it passes through origin, so this is going to be 0. 0, 0, 0 works. So all of these p bars are going to satisfy x plus y plus z is 0. So for all real points, like on the thing, this thing is not going to be equal to 0. And in case it turns out to be 0, you're basically representing one of these p infinity points. Right? we call it P infinity point of like this pi only, because it seems to intersect pi at infinity. But like basically these points, you should just know that what happens if this happens. So basically you're representing those points. Just happens to be those points that you can't reach on the plane. Okay. So all P bar with this satisfying this, all of these will constitute some P infinity. Also notice that P bar and 2P bar are basically the same thing. Like 2x plus 2y plus 2z is 0. They just point in one direction itself. I mean, both of these correspond to the same P infinity. Here also P bar and 2P bar correspond to the same. So if you take this or 2x, 2y, 2z, I'll just call it lambda by 2 times 2x. It doesn't matter. Like it's just some constant. However big your hand is, you could say. You don't care how big it is. The direction is what matters. Okay, so hopefully it's clear till here. Now we can go and define barycentric coordinates. I
Yes.
assume it's clear. So graphically you can view it as P bar is here. You pull P bar till it reaches there. Like you basically scale it up. Or if P bar happened to be here, your hand is like huge, you scale down. So basically that you can find that scaling, you don't care what that is, you just know it's on the plane, that's enough. So basically, array, I shouldn't have erased the diagram. This allows us to define coordinates like this. We'll just give some special, like, so the points on So the points on this plane, P, let's say some P, X, Y, Z, satisfy. Okay, so P, X, Y, Z meaning the vector P bar. This is different from that. So the vector representing the point, so basically this is, usually I'll use like smaller case for the vector. So I'll call this A bar like that. Not side length, the A is, that's important. So this is just x times whatever the x unit is and in the direction of the x-axis plus y times the similar thing for y. Oh, sorry, x was like this, y is like this, plus z times this, right? So what's the unit along the x-axis? What will that be? Okay, wait. Yeah, it's just a bar. Or I'll call it a cap because it's a unit, but it's not a unit vector, meaning its magnitude is not one standard unit. Standard unit is like what we are all used to, meaning the I cap, j cap thing. It's a cap, it's also a unit. It's a unit in this axis, that's all. So this point is still 100. This is what I call one. Maybe it's not called a meter or a centimeter, it's called an a unit. Okay. Or a meter, whatever you want. This is some other unit. So a cap, and this will be b cap. This will be c cap. So any point P, this is true in R cube, meaning like throughout space, that this will be x a cap plus y b cap plus z c cap. Okay. Now if you impose the condition that P is in the plane, so this will also so any point in the plane will be this. Satisfying x plus y plus e equal to 1. That's basically the plane thing, right? So I think this is how you'll see barycentric coordinates defined. So any the set of points P with P equals x a plus y b plus z c such that there the sum of these coordinates is 1 are the ones in the plane. So this is the definition of these are called like the barycentric coordinates of that. You can call it Cartesian coordinates if you'd like. There's no problem in that. So this is the thing. So any point you can represent in that way. And yeah, so now that we have the definition, let's see why this might be useful. So one thing is that let's say you had the triangle somewhere in space. Its coordinates might be messy. So in So you've basically taken like the best possible coordinates to be your vertices of the triangle. That's one thing. It's also symmetric, and we'll see a bunch of other useful ideas, usefulness, and like why this is so nice a little later. Okay, so let's say you have. Okay, so everybody I think is familiar with this. We use signed areas. So what that means is area is signed if it's clockwise. And what do I mean by clockwise? There's something called an area vector, which so basically the area is like half what BA into half BA BC, just the length sine B, right? This you can write as, okay. So suppose you don't want the mod, then you can just define the vector as like this without the mod. And BA cross BC will be like this. So it's going to be that way. So this area seems to be negative. Sorry, I should. Say that way. So suppose this is k cap, meaning now like going back to like the usual coordinate just for a second to see what signed areas are. So if delta is like some delta bar is like some phi k cap, it's going to be plus k cap or minus k cap if this triangle is in the plane, because it's going to be perpendicular to the plane, right? Because these are in the plane. Then like you say the signed area is phi. If this is minus phi. Notice if you swap these, the sign flips, right? It's just A cross B is negative of B cross A. So then you say the max, the area, the signed area is minus 5. So why this is true, meaning why this is useful, is that it tells you that if this area is clockwise, is counterclockwise, then this thing is going to be some plus something k cap. And if it's clockwise, it's minus. So I mean it's very easy to verify. Let's say I take A 0 0 without loss of generality, and B like 1 0, and C is just some x y, right? So the area of this is just y, and like the area is y, and the direction is just going to be like if you take the actual the vector one, it's going to be is half okay half this cross this so xi plus yj cross 1 0 I cap so that's just oh okay yeah that's what okay it's bc cross ba. Doesn't matter, I mean then counterclockwise will be clockwise will be positive. So it's I cap cross xi plus yj. So that's just y over 2 k cap. Y by 2, yeah. Half place, right? So the area is that. So let's say y is up. Y is above the x-axis, then it's like this. Meaning you say area of ABC, right? So like you take AB cross AC. Yeah, I should have drawn that better. So AB half AB cross AC is how you define it, and this definition will give that if it's counterclockwise, that means like AC is above AB in a sense. Then basically that's like y equal to 0. Then this area is clearly y greater than 0. Then this is positive. And if you bring C down so that ABC is like this clockwise, then y is like minus 5 or something, and that's negative. So clockwise areas are negative, counterclockwise areas are positive. So that doesn't matter. It's just some convention, and you can just know that like one of them is positive, one of them is negative. It doesn't matter which one. Okay, so now the area of a triangle ABC, let me just draw it correctly, this counterclockwise area is delta is. I might occasionally forget not write this one. This because of habit of writing delta as a scalar. So this will be AB cross AC. And if this is the origin, then this is AB bar is just B minus A, because again, these are all back to our usual coordinate system. We'll come to our improvised coordinate system a little later. It's B minus A cross C minus A. And if you just expand, B cross C comes minus A cross C, so that's plus C cross A. The A cross A is zero, and the minus A, B cross A will be plus A cross B. So it's a nice symmetric form. A cross B plus B cross C plus C cross A, whole over two, that's delta bar, okay? So now, okay. This, maybe some people are already familiar with this, but I just want to, okay. So now in our case, we have, let's say you have a triangle PQR, okay? PQR all are in the plane of, now x plus y plus z equal to 1 is that plane. That was just a detour to like get some results. And now you have PQR and ABC are somewhere in this plane, somewhere there. All in the plane, and origin is somewhere here. So now the area of PQR by area of ABC is a very neat trick. Notice OPQR, the tetrahedron. I think people can see what I'm getting to if you've already seen barycentric coordinates. That's one very nice expression for that.
What's ABC here?
Huh?
What's ABC here?
ABC are like the triangles. Now we're back to the barycentric system only. ABC are like the triangle vertices. And this box is area.
PQR is in the plane of ABC?
Yes, yes, yes. Just 3 points in the plane. And ABC is called like the reference triangle. So ABC, PQR is just some points. So now notice that OPQR, the tetrahedron OPQR has some height h, and this h is precisely the perpendicular distance from O onto our plane, right? It is some constant. And the volume, sorry, did I say area of tetrahedron? No, I meant volume of tetrahedron. Wait, I didn't say that. Okay. The volume of the tetrahedron, OPQR, is precisely PQR. Have people heard this? I assume it's pretty standard. 1 by 3 base area times height. Right? For the special case of cone, this will be like area of circle. So pi r squared. So base area, here it's a triangle, so it is this. Divide, that's the volume of this, okay? And for ABC, the crucial fact is that PQR are in this plane. So the h is the same. So the area of the volume of trapezium of tetrahedron OABC is going to be just this. Same thing, right? Again, we're talking about signed everywhere. The vectors will take care of that for you, so I'm not explicitly saying each time. So the ratio between the volumes of OPQR and OABC is literally just this. This is what we want. So we just need to get these volumes. And why volumes? Because scalar triple products are super with volumes. So like literally you'll get like a one-line proof with, like, if you convert to this. Otherwise, you'll have to just do a bunch of expansion. So PQR over ABC is just these volumes of these. Now, the volume of a tetrahedron, like, whose sides are, like, X bar, Y bar, adjacent, like, concurrent sides are X, Y, Z, is just 1 over 6. The scalar triple product of that. This is not area, no? It's scalar triple product. So, is that clear? If you don't know this result, that's fine. We won't be using this theorem much. But, I mean, actually, we might use it a little. Yeah, we won't be using this much. like actually you can get everything I'm going to tell without this also. But if you're familiar with this, I assume most of you are, so I'm going to use that. So the volume of the tetrahedron is just that. So now this is just some 1/6 factors and all. The ratio of these scalar triple products. And here notice that they're just OP bar, OQ bar, OR bar, or just P bar, Q bar, R bar. So this happens to be very neatly this. These are not same, the ratio is the same. That's all. Okay. So this is true. And now PQR. So P is like X1A plus or A cap. Yeah, A cap should be better. Yeah, plus Y1B cap plus Z1C cap and so on, right? So now let's just compute. One more thing is that the scalar triple product of ABC is just A cap dot B cap cross C cap. B cap cross C cap is just like BC parallel to like A cap, meaning this is A cap, this is B cap, this is C cap. It's basically like I cap, J cap, K cap, but they just don't have to have the same length here. That's all. So B cross C is here, so it's just BC. In the direction of A cap, right? So why BC? I'm saying it's actually one, but B cross C is like a 2-degree thing. So the value of this is one in direct is one B unit C unit, like centimeter meter or meter square in direction of A cap. B unit, C unit, we already know that, like, let's just call them so B unit was root SB, right? But now it doesn't matter, you can take whatever you want, but B unit is longer to write than root SB. So it's basically this root SBC, right? Or wait, that's this is B and this is C. So it's BC normal units, right? I'm just converting everything to normal units because like when I take this one, I will convert everything to normal units as well because these units are different. So like take their their GCD, things like that, I mean to say. I guess it's pretty clear. I'm probably just telling too much. Okay. So now BC units in that direction. So A dot, that is just A cap BC itself. And it's a scalar now. So it's just ABC units, right? ABC unit cube. That is this value. And this is this thing here. So now, so if I convert to normal unit, when I say normal unit, then I'll use I cap, J cap, K cap, like normal unit. So this is what? X A cap. So this is just A I cap, right? So they're not side lengths. It's root SA actually. So P bar is just AX1 I cap plus BX2, BY1 J cap plus CZ1 K cap, where all these I, J, K are unit vectors and their modulus is 1, right? And similarly for PQR, for Q and R. So I think everybody knows like scalar triple product of three vectors is just like the depth of like their coordinates. I think lots of people have spoken about that already before. So this will just be AX1, BY1, CZ1, AX2, AX3, BB again, this will be Y2, Y3, Z2, Z3, C, 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 BB. So you can remove this B out, you can remove this A out, you can remove this C out. So very painlessly, this will be ABC into like this determinant here. X1, Y1, Z1, X2, Y2, Z2, X3, Y3, Z3, which are the barycentric coordinates of this. P bar is X A cap plus Y B cap, Y1 C cap, right? So basically these the det of their barycentric coordinates is just the ratio of these areas, right? Which is that I'm not going to write the whole thing, but that is the thing. Okay, so
where did x2 and x3 came from?
That is like q and r.
I see.
P bar is that q bar. We're trying to compute this though.
So, yeah.
Like P, Q, R, their box, their skeletal plan. So are, is everybody on the same page?
Can you tell after finding this area, what did you do? Like ABC into determinant of this term?
This?
Yeah.
Okay, after now we just have that ABC there, so I cancel it.
Okay.
And this determinant here, this one, is just PQR by ABC.
Yeah.
Right? Okay, great. So this is considered like one of the main theorems of barycentric coordinates. Okay. So it actually
also,
doesn't... Yeah?
ABC here, the capital ABC, are the unit lengths, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Unit length meaning? Yeah,
like
the length of the unit. Correct.
Yeah.
And like we already showed before that those are like indeed like root S A, root S B, root S C.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just capitalize so that it's not confused with the side lengths A B B C C A as that A B C. Okay. So now we're ready to do like stuff with these. Okay. So first I'm going to, so even if you didn't understand this, that's fine, because we won't be using it much. Use it a little bit in the first approach of doing some stuff. We're going to like build some theory of lines and concurrence and collinearity and stuff. So first we'll do it maybe a conventional way. And after that, once you get used to what you're doing with this, like in barycentric coordinates, then I'll give you like much shorter, like proof without words kind of proofs. So I'm a big fan of those, so I keep trying to find those. So we'll do that after you get the hang of what it means first. Okay. So first thing is equations of lines. How do lines look in our plane in terms of barycentric coordinates? Meaning like some function of x, y, z of a point which is x, y, z in barycentric. Now everything is all barycentric, okay? I mean, barycentric is just Cartesian only. Just those I cap, j cap, k cap, the unit vector lengths are not equal. Okay, so now we already got that the equation of that is, so basically, PQR, right? Let's say these are, we want the line through P and Q. This is x1, y1, z1, x2, y2, z2. And this is x, y, z. Okay? Like just a variable point on the line. So you want the locus of this x, y, z. Nothing is there, just the area is 0. So just plug into previous formula to get this. Just you expand, and that will be your equation. Or it takes this form something x plus something y plus something z equal to 0, right? So any line, okay, fine, that's for later. So any line is like a linear combination of x, y, z equal to 0, set equal to 0, okay? Any line. And if you want to compute those things explicitly, they're just like these. y1, z2 minus y2, z1 is this coefficient of x and so on. For now, we just care that it's some linear combination of that. Okay. So now once we get this, we are in a position to look at intersections of two lines. So let's say there are two lines which are like a1x plus b1y plus c1z equal to 0. a2x plus b2y plus c2z equal to 0. It kind of seems very familiar to linear equations in two variables. But there's three here. So you want the solution to this, meaning you have two lines, they're all in the plane, origin is somewhere here. You want this XYZ. But actually, do you care whether you get this point or is this point fine for you too, if you compute this instead? It's perfectly fine because once you get this, X dash, Y dash, Z dash, you can just divide by their sum and that will be the one here that lies on your plane, X plus Y plus Z equal to 1. You just need to get one of the points on this OP line, right? So what you can do, you can just move this P somewhere till this Z becomes 1. So basically like X by Z, Y by Z, 1. Take lambda as 1 by Z. So this point somewhere P dash is also on this line with the scaling factor 1 by Z. So this point, if you compute this, this is some X and Y. I'll now just even call it like X and Y. Some two things if you find where the third is 1 that is given, then you got P dash. And once you got P dash, you just scale down, or I've drawn it so you scale down. If Z equal to 1 came here, then you just scale up to reach this whatever P that you want, the intersection point. Again, the intersection point, the finger analogy, you just have two lines. You just point your direction where that point is. That will fix your point for you. So what we do, we just set Z equal to 1. Now, how are you allowed to do that? Is basically, maybe somebody is saying that this line is, and this line are that, so how can you put this point? Won't it not lie on these lines? So what you can do is notice that these equations are all of the same degree. That means that you can make this 2, 2, 2 also, and all such points will also satisfy, meaning if P X Y Z satisfied it, then 2x, 2y, 2z will also satisfy it, right? And lambda x, anything. So all on this line will satisfy it, okay? So so even this P dash will satisfy it, right? Since P satisfies it, P dash will also satisfy it. So if that's clear, that's perfect. Otherwise, you can also divide by z, and this will just be c1. So now this is basically what I called X here, or X double dash, I'll just call it X now. And this is just Y, where these are like P dash is coordinates. So if P dash is X, Y1, then A1X plus B1Y plus C1 equal to 0, and A2X plus B2Y plus C2 equal to 0. This is true. So now it's very easy. It's just usual. So you get X by P1, C2. I'll just write it like this. Okay, this is just, I think everybody is familiar with this. So X is like, I'll call this lambda A, this lambda B, lambda C. So X is just lambda A by lambda C, Y is lambda B by lambda C. So our point P dash is just lambda A by lambda C, comma lambda B by lambda C, comma 1. Now this also has fractions, so I don't want P dash. I'll take a P double dash on the line, multiply everywhere by lambda C. This looks cleaner, more symmetric. So this line also, this point is also on this line. So I can represent P is just given by this direction. This ratio is just to indicate P's coordinates are in the ratio lambda A is to lambda B is to lambda C, but they need not be lambda A, lambda B, lambda C only. Some scaling is there, some constant into these. Where lambda A is that, so basically this B1, B2, C1, C2, okay? So that's how you get the intersection. But, I mean, if you have arbitrary lines, you can do that. But in general, it's easier to guess the coordinates. You know they intersect in a line. So like, for example, if I tell you intersect X plus Y equal to 5 and like 3x plus or x something that you won't solve and wait. Yeah, okay, fine. I mean, without solving, you can say that 1-1 is the solution. Like, with practice, it will be very clear that that's a solution, and then you won't solve. I mean, 1-1 is my solution. You know it's unique. You found a solution. So that's the only solution. And you're done. So basically, what you do here, let's say you have an equation x equal to y and another equation z equal to 0. I mean, then you don't care. You found a solution 1-1-0. It may be p dash, it may be twice of that. So any lambda lambda 0 will work. And since you want like p, let's say like the actual one on the plane, then you just divide by like the total sum, the this one. So to get this, so p is actually this, the intersection of this line and this line, right? So is everybody following till here? These two are lines, like the sum linear combination of x, y, and z. Probably if like 2-3 people say, maybe now we're getting a little more.
Yeah.
That yes. Okay. Okay, I assume everybody is clear on this. So, okay. So now we know how to like get the intersection. So now concurrence. Three lines. A1x plus B1y plus C1z equal to 0. A2x. So they need to have some common xyz. So if people know some linear algebra and you want a solution that's not the origin, meaning you don't want all of them 0 as the solution, their sum should be 1, then it's very clear that this det must be 0, right? A non-trivial solution to Ax equal to 0 if people are familiar with that. But anyways, I'm not going to use that. That's like the proof without words. I think you can just get the result.
Oh, why should it be 0?
Huh?
Why should the determinant should be 0?
So basically you can represent this as a1, a2, a3, b1. There's this coefficient matrix, this is called. If you know how matrix thing works, you can write these three equations as just this one equation. Right? This product. Yeah, okay. So now you want some non-zero solution to this, right? And suppose that this det was non-zero. So you write this as Ax bar equals 0. Suppose this det was non-zero, then it has an inverse. And this is just 0. Every term will be multiplied by 0. This is I. So you get x bar is 0. So if this det is non-zero, then your only solution is going to be 0, 0, 0. So if you want some other solution to happen, then this debt has to be 0. Is that clear?
Yeah.
Okay. But anyways, maybe you're wondering that why, I mean, okay, that, so basically it has to be 0, but it turns out that, that's okay. So this debt is 0. So now one more way you could do this is just intersect these two. The intersection must lie on this. Maybe in school you've done it like that. So the intersection we also already know is just lambda A, lambda B, lambda C. Again, you don't care whether it's the exact point or 2 times that point or 3 times that point. So lambda A, lambda B, lambda C is like lambda A plus lambda B plus lambda C times the actual P point of intersection. But you don't care, that's fine. So A 3 lambda A plus B 3 lambda B plus C 3 lambda C must be 0, or A 3, this is this. Similar. So notice that if you put B 1 C 1 B 2 C 2 here, you're just tempted to put the symmetric things here, So you want this thing here. So put the A3 right there. So these get multiplied. You have B3 into this part. So put B3 where? Here. And put C3 here. Right? So this debt, I mean, this debt is basically this whole equation, right? And that is zero. I just rearrange this thing into a nice looking debt. And you can cyclically rotate the rows and the determinant won't change. So this is the same as B1, C1, A1, B2, C2, A2, B3, C3, A3. I just moved them around.
Minus C3 term, but it should be plus
C3. Cyclically it won't. You can look at it like this. B3, C3, A3, you swap these two first, then you swap these two. Each time it will be minus.
But no, I mean like term. When we open the determinant, so it's like B3 and that C1, A1, C2, A2 term, minus C3, yes. And determinant of B1, B2, A1, A2. It's like minus
C3. Yeah, but this determinant, B1, B2, A1, A2, is actually minus lambda C. So the minuses will cancel.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So just like moving around these things, you can move the A1, A2, A3 here. So this debt is zero. That's as claimed. This is A1, B1, C1, A2, B2, C2, A3, B3, C3. That is zero. Okay. So this is like two methods I gave. One is a proof without words. One is a little longer. And there'll be a third method, which is also proof without words. That'll come slightly in a bit. Okay. So we know concurrence, collinearity, stuff. Okay. So notice that the formula for concurrency of three lines, like A1, B1, C1, A2, B2, C2, A3, B3, C3, the condition for them to be concurrent is the same condition for as per the collinearity of the points with coordinates A1, B1, C1, A2, B2, C2, A3, B3, C3. I'm not going to elaborate on that, but you can look up duality. So like just telling that they're the exact same thing, right? Okay. Okay. So okay. So now we are okay, we'll just solve one problem. Let's prove the angle bisector theorem, okay? So, ABC, right? I'm not drawing the plane and like the origin and all, but it's understood that that is the thing. And the incenter. Achha, okay, before that, we have to. Okay, let's get the triangle centers quickly. So, G bar is just A bar plus B bar plus C bar by 3 by definition. So, that XA, YB, ZC. These are A caps or A bars. So it's just 1/3, 1/3, 1/3, right? So G is just this. And the in-center, oh, did I cover that? Okay. Okay, let me just do that quickly. Another way to compute these X, Y, Z is as follows. Let's say you have a point P. I'm just taking inside for like the signed area convenience, but outside if it was there, then this would be negative and stuff. Like signed area PVC is minus of like the mod of the area. So PVC this way. Now this area is just half P cross B plus B cross C plus C cross P. They're just three points in space, right? This is XA. Plus, oops, I'm now writing A bar and not A cap, but that doesn't matter. XA plus YB plus ZC. Now, the B cross B term is zero. Here the C term. So what you have is half XA cross B plus minus ZB cross C plus B cross C. Plus X C cross A minus y b cross c, right? This b cross c terms is just b cross c, 1 minus y minus z, which is the same as x, right? So the x magically comes to be common from all three. It's just x half, a very well-known thing. Array plus c cross a. This is just the area of the triangle. Fine. So area of PBC by area of ABC, everything signed, is just x. Our coordinate x, like where P is x, y, z. Now I'll assume that their sum is 1. So you have like the magical result that this is true. And of course, by symmetry, like you, what we did is basically instead of A bar here, we put XA plus YB plus ZC. So analogously, you have, this will just be the same. Put B there, so APC. And this cycle, this like if ABC are anti-clockwise, then CAB will also be anti-clockwise. So ABC signed area is the same as CAB and same as BCA. So APC is the same as PCA, right? This move is here. So
P is a random point inside ABC?
Yes, not inside also, anywhere. Because this formula holds anywhere, right? That's how we define the signed area.
Yeah, fine.
Okay. So this X is given by PBC by ABC. Y is given by APC, but that's the same as PCA by ABC. And this is what? AB replace C by P. So ABP. ABP is the same as PAB. So PAB by ABC. So I just wrote it this way so it seems symmetric. So P, you can write like this. Like explicitly, you can compute the coordinates just in terms of areas. They're kind of called areal coordinates for that reason. Barycentric coordinates are also called area coordinates. Okay, so we have that. Now since we have like these areas, we can literally like trivialize a lot of formulas you probably already know. And so everybody knows this, I guess, no? That the in-center is the side length A. Right? Right, that's well known, right? Or at least in two dimensions, the in-center I is given by AX1 plus BY1, BX2 by plus CX3 by A plus B plus C. If the vertices are X1, Y1, X2, Y2, X3, Y3, similarly for the Y, right? This, I think, is there. Is never that familiar?
Never heard.
Okay, that's fine. No problem. We'll derive it now. So basically, there's like a somewhat convoluted proof to this usually, at least the one I saw first. So we'll just prove this really quickly. Okay, we'll prove this very quickly. So what we do, we already have these A, B, C there nicely. And in general, given like a triangle, maybe in like your coordinate geometry lessons, you'll have the vertices given and you have to find the circumcenter, orthocenter, bunch of things like that. Basically, these are all saying that multiply something into A, something into B, something into C. Where this A is like X, Y, Z, so you'll have like something for X, something for Y, something for Z, and that will be your thing. Or in two dimensions, just X and Y. That will be like your answer for the circumcenter or whatever. We'll get all of those very quickly using the areal definition. So now for in-center, we know the in-center is in the plane. So it's some X A bar plus Y B bar plus H C bar. We know what this X is now. That's the nice part. So if this is R, this is A. PBC is extremely easy to calculate. It's just AR by 2. Where A is now the side length. This A bar is different. This A is different. A is the side length, small a. So this is just some R by 2 into AA bar plus BB bar plus CC bar. Don't care. I mean, this is just some constant. Like this ABC, like P is this comma, this comma, this. So P is also PBC is to Like this is the one because PBC plus PCI plus PAB is just ABC, no? PBC plus PCI plus PAB. So these are already like set to one, the sum is one. But we don't care about that one. Again, it would compute the area of that unnecessarily. So just do that. This and this. So basically, this is just some constant. This is not A. R by 2 into this thing. AR by 2, BR by 2, CR by 2. So this we don't care. And now we'll have to divide by the sum so that the sum of this X, Y, Z is 1. So this is exactly I as claimed, right? So basically this area just makes it very easy. Are people clear on that? We'll just literally just do the exact same thing for the others.
In that, like when you wrote I vector above, where is the R by 2?
Okay, wait. So actually, if you want me to use the exact thing, so what I was doing, I'm just conveniently not computing ABC's area and just saying ratio, and then later on just dividing by the sum of the coordinates, so this XYZ sum to 1. If you want to take exactly that, so ABC is just RS. So it'll be AR by 2, A bar, plus BR by 2, these PBC things. So what I did is, I just said R by 2 is a constant. We don't care, the ratio is going to be same. So I'll just take AA plus BB plus CC. Now I have to divide by A plus B plus C to keep this X as A by A plus B plus C, Y as B by B plus C, Z as C by C, A plus B plus C. So their sum is 1. So if you want to do that way also,
yeah, sure.
Right. And indeed, that's how it's proved, right? RS, AR by 2 plus BR by 2 plus CR by 2. PBC plus PCF plus this ABC. So it'll take care of that for you. So again, if you would like, the 2 will come here, this RS cancelled. 2S, that's A plus B plus C. So I'm just like, we don't care what it is, it's something. And then later we'll just take care that you divide by the total. Okay. So now, ortho center. Again, literally just do the same. HBC, this length is, I think, well known to R cos B cos C. If you're well versed in like triangle solving. But it's okay if you don't know that. You can easily get it. It's just trigonometry. So this is again A. This is just what? I'm now just going to look at the ratios. The ratio of the area is just these R and R are constants. So it's just A cos B cos C. Just multiply cos A and by cos A. This again, cos A cos B cos C is a constant. So it's A by cos A. And A by cos A, we know that SA is B squared plus C squared minus A squared by 2, which is also by the cosine rule BC cos A. So this thing, I'll just multiply BC. Again, ABC is a constant, so I don't care. BC cos A is just SA, so 1 by SA. So H is 1 by SA is to 1 by SB is to 1 by SC. Or SBSC, multiplying SA, SBSC. Right? So that's H. Then you can divide by their sum. Their sum is actually very neat, but we'll come to that in a little time. You can just expand also if you want. So that will give. So H is that, right? And if you want the commas, by like this sum. Now, O will just be... one more thing. It's A by cos A, right? A by cos A. So A by cos A, 2R sin A, the 2R is constant. So sin A by cos A, tan A. So basically the H's coordinates are in the ratios of tan. Meaning... if H was X, Y, Z, then X is to Y is to Z is the same as tan A is to tan B is to tan C. That also you probably saw many times. It's just A bar into tan A plus B bar into tan B plus C bar into tan C by tan A plus tan B. You can do that also. It just happens that this SB's sum comes very nice. Nicer like than the sum of the tans. So you just use that. This is also equivalent. So H is literally this. This also, I think, is kind of well known if you're doing like, I think if you're doing proper coordinate geometry and stuff, you probably came across this. Let's just repeat for circumcenter. This time, this thing is very nice. OB is just R. If this is A, then this angle is also A because this total is 2A. So this perpendicular length is just R cos A. So it's just A R cos A by 2. R by 2 is just a constant. So it's just A cos A. A cos A, this will just be 2R sine A. So R, I don't care. This is just sine 2A. So instead of tan A, the ratio is sine 2A this time. You can write in terms of SBs, but I'm not going to bother doing that now, right? So basically, just it's just the same process. Just get that area. I mean, one of the base is also nicely fixed for you. You just have to get the perpendicular distance. That's very easy for the nice triangle centers. Okay, so is that clear? Now we can do some doing. Okay, so now A100, B00010. We'll prove angle bisector theorem, and then we'll go to the proof without words of the collinearity and concurrence ones. So let's say the incenter is this, and let's say this intersection. So barycentric, we already know how to compute intersections. What's the equation of line BC? Just guess. You know it's linear, and you know it contains these, and there's the unique line. These two are like zero, so you can just say this works, right?
Y
Similarly,
plus z
AB
equal to
will just
1.
be what? Z equal to zero.
Oh, BC is y plus z equal to 1 also works, no?
Which one?
BC.
Yeah, x equal to zero meaning x plus y plus z is one, right?
Yeah.
So those u at u, I mean the those this thing I wrote here, those are not unique. They're like you can take a lot of things. Just linear, that's important. So you can guess. So I is ABC. Now here, when you have two zeros and this, how can you guess? You can of course just compute. Ah, by the way, this ABC is actually A by A plus B plus C, so on. But this det is zero, so those scalings don't matter. So in general, except for a few cases, the scalings don't matter. So you can easily like just think through and see, do I need to take A by A plus B plus C here? If you realize, oh, I can just pull out this thing common from all of them and then just multiply. So then I don't care. ABC is fine with me. Right? So this 0, 0 expand from here. What will you get? This one. So you'll get CY equal to BZ. Or you can notice that these things are zero. So zero is whatever you want into zero. Whatever you want into zero is whatever you want into zero. So you just find some things here such that like it's something into the y coordinate and something into the z coordinate. Z is C, so choose B and C here. So CB is equal to BC, and that's fine. And this 0, 0 equation will automatically just work for you, right? Because you just took coincide. Is that clear why how you can arrive at it directly?
Yeah.
Okay. So CY equal to BZ intersect that. Right? That is D. Just the intersection of these lines. How did we get arbitrary intersection? Just take one as whatever you want. So anyway, X is fixed as zero. I'll use ratio so that getting one of those p dashes or p double dashes. Z I'll choose c because I don't want fractions. I can choose one, then I'll get y as b by c. And then anyways I'll just multiply everywhere by c. So I'll just choose z is c, then y will come b, so you get the same thing. So d is 0 is to b is to c, and now if you like get the exact d bar is 0 a cap plus b by b plus c d cap plus c by b plus c c cap. Now, suppose BD is to DC was P over Q and this is the origin somewhere. Then you also know that D bar is just P times C bar plus Q times D bar by B plus Q. I'll just take like p plus q is 1, like lambda is to 1 minus lambda, like that, okay? Or maybe I assume people are more familiar with taking k is to 1 or m is to 1. Okay, fine, let's do that.
Oh, how did this come?
Oh, this is just vectors linear combination thing.
Like
OD bar is...
Yeah, how did that come?
That is just like, if you look at it, like it divides in this. I mean...
Oh, yeah, fine, got it.
You can give a formal proof. I mean, the formal proof is just like this. It's basically that you write B bar in terms of BX, BY, BZ.
Yeah, I got it.
Okay. So MC, let's say it's M is to 1, okay? Then MC bar plus B bar plus by M plus 1. That's what you do in like section formula and stuff also. No? So D bar is that. And you also know this, C cap. So what m by m plus 1 is just c by b plus c, and b by b plus c is 1 by m plus 1. So m plus 1 is 1 plus c by b, so that m is c by b, right? And that will also work. So they can clearly see c by b works here. The b's will cancel, here c plus b will come. So M is C by B, which means this ratio is C is to B, right? And that's just angle bisector theorem. AB is C, AC is B, right? So just intersecting the line, you don't have to do anything. Just intersect the line and then you'll just get angle bisector theorem. You can get lots of theorems like that. Now you just know, like just take any theorem in the book, intersect all the lines, you'll get it. So usually it just seems more work than it actually is. It's like much quicker, like when you just guess equations of the lines and intersect them quickly by taking one of the variables as some convenient number to avoid fractions, stuff like that. That you will just get better with practice. Okay, so now, like, you know how to like intersect lines and stuff. Now let's look at the proof without words of that. So any line is of this form, right? Which I can rewrite, where R bar represents the point P. Okay? So it's just X A cap plus Y B cap plus Z C cap. So what this means is that there's a vector U perpendicular to R. See, it's very clear that that U is not unique. You can have any of these in the circle, you can scale U, you can do lots of things. There's some vector, right? So now, if you want three points to be collinear, okay, then it's, 1 second, did I say it this way or? Okay, fine, that's okay. So, okay, fine, yeah, I will do it that way, okay. Anyways, so it basically is like, there is some U, that's what you found here, UVW, which is perpendicular to your vector of P, the point P on this line, okay? So now, let's see what a line is actually. And now whoever attended the previous class, this will be kind of very obvious to you, right? So given a point P in our plane and some line like this, okay, this is the origin, line through P and Q, let's say, OP and OQ bar are drawn here. Oops, let me draw a better diagram. Right? This line is what you want. Okay? I'm not drawing x plus y plus z equal to 1. Notice that this line can be thought of as the intersection of the plane OPQ, right? intersecting x plus y plus z equal to 1. This is x plus y plus z equal to 1. The plane through like OPQ triangle intersecting this x plus y plus z equal to 1 or pi is a line and it's precisely PQ, right? This I covered in the previous one as well.
Yeah.
So any line can be just represented by a plane through the origin. And what's a plane through the origin? It's of the form ux plus vy plus wz equal to 0 for some x, y, z. And proof without words. So any line is of that form. You don't need the big theorem we proved about the triple products and then said that determinant is 0 if they're collinear. So that's the equation of a line. Like x, y, z and 2 points, you just get it directly. And so the physical significance of this UVW is, of course, the normal vector if the plane through P and Q was something and it intersected R plane in this line. The normal vector to this first plane, which represents PQ, is given by U bar, right? So now we got the equation of a line. Now let's see, three lines are collinear. What does that mean? Their three planes are concurrent in a, like their three planes concur in a line. Is that clear?
Yes.
If you have three lines like this, this is the origin, all their three planes are like this. Oh, okay, the drawing came reasonably well. Then all these three have this common line. And what's the line? That's the line that represents the point of concurrence, P. In the starting, we talked about how just the line represents the point. So this line of intersection of the planes that represents that represent the three lines concur at P. This line is the one that represents P, right? And the planes are the ones that represent the three lines, okay? So now, for them to conquer, that means for these three planes to have a common, like to intersect in a line, it's well known, I guess, that it's just like if the planes are like AX plus BY plus CZ, three planes, A1, B1, C1, that this debt must be zero for that. You can, an easy way to show, again, it's circular, but this is the graphical thing, that you can use the previous, like A1X plus B1Y plus C1Z, meaning, the matrix thing, that's faster, or you could do the normal, but I'm just saying that if you know this, then like it's a proof without words. So, I think I covered this previously also, right?
The concurrence of three planes, you mean?
The concur, like when three planes intersect in a point.
Yeah, it was in the last
one. Yeah. So it's okay if you didn't get that. But anyways, I'm saying like if you knew that, then this is a proof without words. So, like nothing. Those lines are just three planes. Those planes must intersect in a line. So this debt is zero, right? Now let's just go to, we saw concurrence of three lines, right? So now collinearity of 3 points. So 3 points are on a line, meaning that their vectors are coplanar. Why? Because the plane in which they lie is basically the plane that represents this line through these 3 points, PQR, which are collinear. It's just that plane. So they're clearly coplanar, and if they're coplanar, then their scalar triple product is zero, which is the same as PQR, is zero, which is that whole thing. Okay. Actually, like this P will be X A I cap again. You have to write like that, and this will be X A. You need these to be I cap. You need these to have magnitude 1. Then you can use the... Again, it just like becomes similar to that proof we did of the PQR by ABC area formula. You do this, the ABC from each of these will cancel. You're left with this, okay? If you understood, then there's nothing to write. It's clear, okay? So I assume it's clear now? Like the second or third proof of these. So basically, the power of like viewing points as lines and lines as planes, you get a lot of these nice results very quickly. All right, so now just one final notion. Like now, basically, you can handle problems yourself. Only one thing is distance. The distance, let's say you have a point P on the plane. Now notice, okay, P and Q, and you want this distance. This distance is just, right, mod of the difference vector. Because this vector is just Q minus P. So this PQ bar is just defined as Q minus P. So it's just mod Q minus P, right? The length of this vector, that's the distance PQ. So clearly notice that here, P and Q you must set so that their sum is 1. You cannot take any scaling and like pull out common and say it doesn't matter. Because clearly this Q dash, if you didn't set to 1, this distance is like not even close to the real distance. Like kind of arbitrary. So you have to set both of them to 1 to get the actual distance between them. Okay, so now assuming you set all of them to 1 and then P was x1, y1, z1 with their sum 1, Q is x2, y2, z2 with its sum 1, then Q bar minus P bar is like x2 minus x1, y2 minus y1, z2 minus z1, I'll call it alpha, beta and gamma, where alpha plus beta plus gamma, this is A cap, B cap, C cap, so it's alpha A plus beta B plus gamma C, where alpha plus beta plus gamma is 0 here. It's 1 minus 1, so 0. Because each of these sum to 1. Okay, so now, very, very, very useful trick. Mod this if you want, this square, and write it as a dot product. Now Q minus P is just this one. Alpha A cap. Notice A dot A is right. And just any vector dot itself is just its length squared, and this one's length was A. So A squared is A cap dot A cap. It was not 1. That is what is important. So this, or if you want, you can just write I cap plus beta B, J cap. You know what these ABCs are. I'm just calling ABC. This dot itself, which is just this one's mod squared.
What's alpha beta gamma here?
That this, like alpha is x2 minus x1.
Oh, okay, fine.
And its sum is 0. So this will just be SA alpha squared plus SB beta squared plus SC gamma squared. Right? That's the square of the distance between P and Q. Okay? There's also another way in which you can
write this. How is A square equal to SA? Isn't like SA that big term for that?
Array, these ABC are only the lengths of our units, no? And we showed that lens was so this is the thing. You can write it in one more way that will usually be seen, and that's a good approach. So I'll just finish with that. That's a nice way. So notice that if you have P bar, a point P with XA plus YB, this is Z C. The fact that they sum to 1 implies that P bar minus any vector R is this. right? So like what is nice here is that let's say I will call this A bar now. The A is not the same as this one. Just calling that for this for some point R, and I will choose R as the circumcenter. Okay.
Oh wait, and this shouldn't there be like when you take A vector minus R vector, shouldn't that be like R of X part?
Right. So you have to add, I mean, you subtracted R here. So you subtract R this side also. You write that subtract R as this. X plus Y plus Z is 1. That's the crucial part. And then give the Rx to the A term, the Ry to the B term, and Rz to the C term. And that's clear?
Yeah.
Okay. So that's the crucial thing of why this thing is that. Okay. So I take circumcenter as my R. And all points, all the vectors now are called by capital. So P is XA plus YB plus ZC, where all of these vectors are with respect to the circumcenter now. Because if this was A bar, this was O bar. Now A minus O is this. So it seems to be like O is the origin. This is B, this is C, like that. Right? This is C minus O. Or capital C bar. This is capital B bar, capital A bar. So everything is with respect to the circumcenter now. Why circumcenter? Because now notice what's A bar dot A bar. It's just OA squared, which is R squared. And that's the same as B dot B and C dot C. Like you basically have to choose, you'd like to choose R bar as the point where the distance from all those three points is the same. And that point is the circumcenter. So you choose the circumcenter. Okay. And why you want them to be same? Because like, I mean, we'll see in a bit why that like makes it very nice. So you have this. Also, one more nice thing is that what's A dot B? I'll write it. Okay. So our diagram looks like this. A, B. See, circumcenter, this is B bar, A bar, C bar, right? This is 2C. So A dot B is just AB, is just RR, like mod A mod B, cos 2C, right? That's R squared, 1 minus 2 sine square C, which is R squared minus half 2R sine C whole squared. And 2R sin c is just small c. Small c, now the side length c, right? Is R square minus small c squared by 2. That's A dot B. So we have, it's very easy to compute all of these. Like any of ABC dot any of the others is very easily computable and very neat also.
Right? Oh wait, O is there the origin or circumcenter of ABC?
O is circumcenter of ABC.
And
which
like,
kind of behaves like origin because these A bar, B bar, C bar originate from it, right? By definition, B minus O, A minus O. I mean, like O, this is the actual origin, this is circumcenter, and this is A. So I said I will call A minus O, this is small a, as A, right? This is O, the circumcenter, not zero vector. Mm-hmm. This vector is A minus O. Yeah. This is precisely A bar. That's just by addition. O plus A minus O is A.
Yeah, sure.
So this A bar seems to be like the circumcenter is the origin. But it's not the actual like OA where O is the origin. O is somewhere here. Right? This is small A bar. This is capital A bar. Okay? Just want to make this point clear so that later you can manage on your own. This A, okay? So now why that's nice is because like all these hold. You can just compute any dot product. And now let's say you want like PQ are these coordinates. And also important to note is that this XYZ and this are the same. we just subtract like circumcenter bar on both sides. These are the same. Okay. If px1, y1, z1, qx2, y2, z2. So pq bar, like q capital Q minus capital P, is actually equal to small q minus small p, right? Capital Q is just small q minus O, and that will cancel the O from the P capital P bar. This is this. And this is the same alpha, x2 minus x1, but this time capital A bar and not small a bar. Okay? So if you want this length, you can say small q minus small p is capital Q minus capital P, and that's equal to this. Now the dot product is nice because like all of these you know, A, B, A, all those you know. In the previous case also you knew, but the formula is like it has SA and all, which is kind of hard to like compute very quickly. So these are all easy, A, B, C like usually are given also. So you have this. Now their dot, I am going to skip the calculation because we're short on time. So you get that, this is just PQ, right? PQ length square is this, which is this square, which is this square. That will be, okay, I'm going to very quickly do it. Alpha squared, A dot A. A dot A is this, so that will be alpha squared. B dot B also same, this. Plus, summation cyclic, 2 alpha beta A dot B, right? And A dot B is R square. You should do this like yourself later, right? So now take R square common, alpha squared, beta squared, gamma squared, 2 alpha beta, 2 beta gamma, 2 gamma alpha. So alpha plus beta plus gamma whole squared. And that is actually 0. Alpha plus beta plus gamma is this minus this, which is 1 minus 1, so 0. This cancels. Notice that you must have these 1, 1. Like there shouldn't be like points at infinity and stuff. Or origin also. Don't worry about that. There shouldn't be points at infinity. And this will just be, this 2 will cancel. So minus summation c squared alpha beta. If the displacement vector pq bar, it's called displacement vector, is alpha small or capital, doesn't matter, then the distance is this, which is positive, though it has a minus sign here. This is the root of this is the distance, right? Because pq squared was that. So if you want, you can just expand the SA as VSC and use the fact that the sum of these is 0 and show that our initial formula and this are the same.
Oh, can you tell how this alpha plus beta plus gamma is 0?
Oh, alpha is x2 minus x1?
Yeah. Oh yeah, fine. Both of these are 1. Yeah.
You have to keep all of them 1 for the distance thing. Otherwise, it doesn't make sense as we saw, right?
Yeah.
So just give arbitrary scaling. Distance also, is not scaled.
Yeah. PQ are random points in the x plus 5 plus z equal to 1.
Yes. Okay. Yes, they are on that thing. Yeah. Okay, so we are done. I mean, you have basically all the theory you need. You can. EGMO has pretty good theory explanation, I mean pretty good like theory content. It has like a lot of things, so you can see that I've like proved everything, so and tried to prove them in such a way that like it feels obvious. I mean, many proof without words and stuff, those are nice, so you can like just dive into the problems, or maybe there are a few identities with the SA, SB, SC things, so you can check those out in the EGMO. They're easy to prove, just like in general, like you can just write SA as 2 delta cot A. This delta you write as half BC sin A. Then that's just BC cos A, which is true. So when you use these, you can get all those results of relating them. I'm not going to cover that. This, it's there in that. So all the theory part I've covered. And it's 8:41. Okay. Are you guys fine with like couple minutes? I just wanted to show that OI, the Euler distance, the root r square minus 2rr is kind of obvious in barycentric, meaning nothing is there. You can get it in like 5 seconds.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Krishna, just like try to wrap up as soon as you can.
Yeah, like couple minutes. It won't take much. This is very short. Yeah. So you just want OI, right? OI bar is just I bar, like capital I bar. Okay, it's just this OI thing, right? And that is equal to what? A by A plus B plus C. A plus B plus C is 2s. So A by 2s, A plus B by 2s, B plus C by 2s, C. Done. You got I bar. You want its magnitude. You know all of these dots. Just get it. So if this is D, then D squared is just these things dot. Notice now here, like, this is not a displacement vector. It's just like a, it's not like OP minus OQ or like Q minus P kind of thing. It's just one thing. So that alpha plus beta plus gamma is 1 minus nothing. It's just 1. It's not 0. And so that thing will be like A by 2s plus B by 2s plus C by 2s whole squared minus summation C squared alpha beta, right? Till here we didn't use that the sum is 0. It's just sum alpha beta. Alpha beta meaning these. A by 2s, B by 2s. This is just 1. So r squared minus, this is CCAB. So this ABC, move it out. 4S squared, move it out. Summation C, that's just 2S, right? So 2S by 4S squared, that will be 2S. So it's just ABC by 2S. Now, ABC, okay, so ABC by 2S. ABC is 4 capital R delta is well known, I assume. This 2 R delta bias is just R as required. So literally nothing was there. You just, I is like direct, you already showed it. Just dot it against that and you will get the answer. You can get OH this way. Just put in the S and you'll need some relations about the SASBSC thing, because you have to divide, no? So you'll need that, some manipulation things, but you can get OH. You can do even more. You can do, you know, the area of triangle PQR, right? Now for any PQR, you can get these for a triangle and stuff. You can prove HGO collinear. That's actually a very nice exercise. You should try that. You can get all of these, which normally also you can do constructing a lot of right triangles and stuff, then using half BC sine A, getting some lengths. It's just very cumbersome and it's kind of very quick here. So yeah, I'm done. That's all I had for today. Okay. Abhay, you can stop recording.